My name is Modestus Nnamdi, Onyeaghalaji, from the University of Lagos. I actually teach philosophy, but I specialize in the area of moral philosophy. Also, I've done a lot of works in the area of what's called culture. And, basically, that's what it is. I'm here to present a paper on ethics and aesthetic creativity, a critical reflection on the moral purpose of African art. So basically, the work focuses on the moral purpose of African art. What actually stimulated this paper was that I was listening to the contemporary African music, especially Nigerian music. The only thing I could hear was the drums, shaking bonbon, money, and popping champagne, and all that. So, secondly, I also had the opportunity of visiting Mike's Art Gallery at Lekki. It's one of the largest art galleries in Nigeria. I also interacted with her, and I had the opportunity of moving around with her, and she showed me some of the contemporary arts. So after looking at them, I realized that there is something happening with the art in Nigeria, especially the contemporary art in Nigeria. So that made me to inquire into this idea of art, especially in Nigeria. Of course, I'm sure that there's a reflection of that in other African countries. So that's why I titled the paper Ethics and Aesthetic Creativity. So my intention is to investigate or to interrogate the moral status of contemporary African art. So the work is actually divided into three. The first part deals with conceptual clarification, where I look at the idea of art, aesthetic creativity, and the notion of morality, because the whole idea is to look at the idea of morality in the contemporary art. So the second part examines the idea of African art. The idea of African art, we look at it from both the traditional and the contemporary. And the last part, where we make some suggestions of to respond to some of the problems we identified as confronting the idea of contemporary art. So the first part, which is art, aesthetic, and morals. The first thing we did is to try to conceptualize the idea of aesthetics. And we said that aesthetics is concerned with beauty as it relates to art. Beauty as it relates to art. And in philosophy, we call it philosophy of art. So what we do in philosophy with regard to aesthetics is to examine the idea of beauty or the value of beauty with regard to art. So we look at different areas that scholars try to examine the notion of art in different areas of human commitment. And when we do that, we realize that we cannot talk about aesthetics without talking about art. So the question is, what is art? Basically, we have different conceptions of art, but that's what we call the root meaning, which emphasizes the notion of skill, technique in making things. So generally, you can see art as the skill or technique in constructive attitude. So there are different art works, there are different art productions, there are different art creativity, but basically our emphasis is in the area of music and what we call textile arts, because these are the areas we actually investigated with regard to the contemporary aspect of life. There's also an idea of art which we consider very important in this discussion. There's a scholar we call John Dewey. He says art is a unified experience. It's a process of reordering our experiences in order to create symbols, create images for social good. It is a way of interpreting our experiences in order to provide new ways for human understanding. So we consider that definition as very important, and we use it as central to our understanding of art, especially when we are investigating the idea of African art. So one question that came to our mind at this point is, what is actually the value of art? Does art have value for human society? Seriously, when you look into the history, there are some scholars who have argued that art has no value at all, except what we call aesthetic contemplation. If we read Plato, there's a scholar we call Plato in philosophy. He believes that, in fact, art is a corruption of reality, and as such, is a corruption of human mind. But beyond that, we also have scholars who have argued seriously that art has serious implication in terms of moral contribution for human society. And there's a scholar I also mentioned, we have a lot of scholars we mentioned, but one important scholar is Chinajere in Arabo. He says that art helps us to see what the rest of us cannot see with our limited vision. So if that is the case, the question now is, does art have value for African society? Not only whether it has value, but does it have what we call moral value for African society? Now, before we go into that, we realize that it's also important for us to understand what is morals or morality, because this is central to our understanding. In philosophy, morality is discussed under ethics. So what we do is to try to understand those foundations, those principles that are important for human understanding, those principles that are important for conducting human life. Now, having said that, we now move to the gist of our matter, and that is, what is African art? How is it being conceived? Now, if we look into the history, we realize that there was a time the idea of African art was a serious problem. In fact, the Western scholars said Africans do not have idea of art. That was their belief, that Africans do not have intellectual virtue, they don't have intellectual strength even to conceptualize idea of art. So aesthetic creativity was actually elusive in Africa. Now, the African scholars tried to respond to this proposal. Most scholars argue that, well, it's not true, Africans have idea of art, but our idea of art is different from the Western conception. So they made two distinctions. One, they said, Africans have idea of art, but our art is functional, our art is symbolic. Then secondly, they also argue that African art is different from Western art because Western art is individualistic, which only emphasizes the individual emotional relations. But African art is communal, it is community oriented, it is moral, and also it is depersonalized, meaning that the African art tries to interpret the cultural experience of the Africans. And when you look at this seriously, you realize that art basically is a reflection of people's experiences, people's ontology, people's worldview, people's ideas. So if we now take it generally, as the African art from the traditional standpoint actually emphasized community ideas, communalism, and idea of communicating African experiences, African morality, and African belief system. Now the question is, our contemporary art, how far does it go in communicating these communal ideas? How far does it go in communicating these moral foundations that we are embedded in African culture? Now, when we look at, when we try to answer this question, realize that truly there are different attempts that have been made by Africans, you know, to project these African worldviews. If you look at the traditional African music, for instance, the music of people like Osedebe, even Fela, you realize that they try as much as possible to interpret human experiences. They try to challenge even the foundation of our practical experiences. But now, come back to our Africa, the contemporary time. How far does our contemporary art provide these worldviews, challenge these worldviews, present the moral foundations that could help us in what we call in social coordination, social collaboration, and social understanding? Now, we realize that the contemporary African art seems to be far from that. But we can excuse them a little bit due to two basic factors. One, the African art seem to move towards what we call the rational criteria of value of the Western principles. Now, when the Western scholars said that Africans do not have art or the idea of intellectual virtue to even produce art, they did so because of their definition of art. They said that art can only include those objects that are made for aesthetic purposes, while African art is functional and symbolic. Now, what that means is that the African art was rejected by the West because they feel that they were symbolic, they were functional, they do not have what they call aesthetic purposes. But now you realize that the Africans challenge that position, but our contemporary art seem to move or gravitate towards that belief. They are now moving towards the idea that, okay, we have to make our art appreciable by the West. And when you look at it, you find out that most artists today produce their artworks with the intention of achieving the Western delight. Then secondly, we also realize that there's another factor that affects our African art, which is what we call materialism. Materialism, or scholar call it mercantilization. That is an attempt to seek for money. And there's a work I wrote, I call it Money and Morals. So you realize the quest for money has actually influenced an attempt of artists to produce anything African. Even when they try to make it African, you see there's a pinch of this Western color. So in other words, they attract the Western ideology so that the West can buy it. I remember when I went to this Nike art theater, I was there for almost like 10 minutes. I was there for almost like 20 minutes. The people that came and bought the arts were actually the whites. The Africans that came, either a boy and girl will hold hands, walk around, and move out. So you find out that this idea of materialism seems to be fundamental in actually influencing an attempt to produce an idea of art in Africa. So now, finally, we realize that if we have to incorporate the idea of moral foundation, the idea of communalism, and of course the personalized idea that we are fundamental in the traditional African art, there's a need for us to go back in our art positivity to begin to reflect on what actually can we do by way of art in order to project our African ideas. Well, there are other suggestions I gave here, but in summary, I suggested that there's supposed to be what we call quality control. You know, quality control is actually elusive as far as Nigerian music is concerned. When I mean quality control, the quality control cannot only come from the government, of course, and the people themselves should also look inwards and begin to interact, of course, begin to converse in ways of revaluing our values, because so that's what's very fundamental in Nigeria. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now, the issue of development in African society actually dominated the papers presented since the commencement of this conference. And this paper is actually an attempt to contribute to the chorus generated by the multiple discourse since yesterday. In this case, we are looking at the appropriate standard for the evaluation of our social and political concerns in Africa. That means the direction that we should take that will lead us out of the woods. Actually, studies from social sciences suggest that the quest for this standard might appear to some at first quixotic, that's confusing. But this is so because it is difficult to decipher the challenges confronting the development of African culture without unearthing the problems encountered by the exposure of culture to other forms of life. In this instance, colonialism and globalization are actually the international trends that have called to question the views, ideas, and practices of African culture. Now, the implication of this encounter have actually made us to redefine our understanding of the African project and brought them back on the development of the platform that will best account for the needs and interests of Africa in a manner that will promote social solidarity and human progress. Two platforms are identified. First, the traditional view that promotes indigenous ideas of man, society, and nature as the foundation and pathway to social reconstruction. The second one, however, are those that argue for the enlargement of our concept of the universe by critically engaging our values and beliefs. Now, this involves, as Abraham says, the distillation and the integration of many cultural streams, sorted and sifted until we can actually adequately account for the needs and interests of man's physical and social environment. And this does not in any way undermine the relevance of culture in organizing our social lives or creating order and social integration, as we will see later in the following. Now, the actual aim here is to discuss the nature of the values that sweep Africans' effort to cope with the forces that are detrimental to our survival in terms of man's energy to move or to cope with the challenges of nature. Now, the main objective here is to argue that scholars that have emphasized indigenous values will actually make our conception of our realities and epistemology unnecessarily insular. Now, those studies have examined the platform that will best account for the interests and needs of Africans in line with man's effort to cope with the challenges of nature. The traditional perspective that argues for the promotion of individual values of man in the society we believe is wrong-headed because it creates an illusion that we know everything about man and his environment from our knowledge of ourselves. The studies therefore challenge the traditionalist view by exploring a perspective that enlarges our conception of the universe and provides a clearer picture of the fabric of our concepts and the critical appraisal of our beliefs. Now, by critical appraisal of our culture, we mean the reconstruction and promotion of those aspects of our culture using the theoretic and intellectual skills that philosophy provides in comparison with what obtains elsewhere, to identify areas that need to be adjusted in line with man's efforts to cope with the challenges of their daily human experiences. Now, the question is, what is the place of philosophy in all this? Now, the question of the task of philosophy in the promotion of human values is not easy to give a clear-cut definition, because that will be based that it will depend on the standpoint of whoever is talking. Now, however, one answer that easily comes to mind in line with the above is that philosophy is a critical reflection of the concepts and principles we use in the organization of our experiences in morals, religion, social, and political life. In fact, as Stanley says, philosophy is a criticism of the ideas we live by. By this, we mean appraising positively the ideas that guide our human operations. This involves the examination of those ideas we mostly take for granted, the assumption of which we are scarcely aware, but which underline our supposed knowledge. Everything we do sometimes is controlled by, or at least affected by, our assumptions, even though we may not be aware of them, we may not be conscious of them. The task of philosophy is to examine these and test their soundness or otherwise. Because as Stoico says, it is a man that is unaware to do this that is kept in bondage to these assumptions. What then is the nature of this bondage? And how do we overcome it in a world that is now a global village? In the pursuit of the development of human values, particularly at the twilight of the 20th century, scholars have exclusively focused on African political economy without due regards to the cultural aspect of our lives. The reasoning here is that once we settle the political and the economic aspects of the life of a nation, then other things will follow. This is obvious, but it is not sufficient for an all-round development of human values in Africa. However, it is important to know that we cannot achieve much if we ignore those characteristics of a people that make them different from others, in terms of which we can evaluate their values positively or progressively or otherwise. To see how this is possible, it is imperative to discuss culture as a factor in the sustainability of human values and social integration. The first step in this direction is to see culture as that complex whole which goes beyond arts, songs, or other symbolic resources, and dance to include everything that is connected with the people's way of life. So conceived, then, interpretation of the people's worldview is a constant phenomenon and subject to variation by reason of the influence of external pressure. It follows that the people's cultural practices and by implication of their identity cannot be static. This explains the synergy between culture and human development. But as a dynamic process, the aspects of our cultural practices, beliefs, and ideas which are considered to be anachronistic or inimical to societal, socioeconomic progress in consonance with dynamics of individuals and societal needs and interests are always in constant flux. And again, that's why I try to tie the relationship between culture and human development and the place of culture in shaping the identity of individuals and society. Seen as a people's way of life, therefore, culture can be defined as a regulator of the activities of the society, and by so doing, it creates order in the society and creates in the consciousness of our people a sense of shared values by which we can differentiate not only in arts, dance, morals, but in their reactions to common concerns, thus generating the basis for the formulation of common identity and the cooperation required in its pursuit. In this way, culture does not only create a platform for the attainment of social integration, it makes human history intelligible and significant. This is why culture is seen as a fruit of history. And in Ralph Pittman's works, articulated through the historical accumulation of human values. Change in the identity of individuals and their extension, their culture, can be linked to the influence or dialogue between the individual and the cultural world. But what is responsible for this change in culture and identity? The answer is a complex process and forces of change, which for convenience can be summed up as globalization. Now, globalization for Anthony McGrew refers to those processes operating on a larger scale, which cut across national boundaries, integrating and connecting communities and organizations in new space-time combination, making the world in reality and in experience more connected. Now, the new temporal and spatial features, which account for the compression of distance and time, are among the significant aspects of globalization affecting cultural identities. Now, as these cultures are affected by these exposures to activities of other clients, it becomes difficult to preserve cultural activities intact or to prevent them from being weakened through cultural bombardment from infiltration. The implication of all this is that modern societies are by definition in perpetual flux. This is what distinguishes our position from the traditional perspective that some are presenting for the conduct of our experiences, irrespective of their relevance to our needs and interests. From this, we can see the difficulty in developing a critical mind that will generate the kind of ideas and activities that will lead to the advancement of human values in Africa. It is clear that an authoritarian regime arising from the insistence on the promotion of indigenous values cannot harbor the habits of thoughts that are important instruments of scientific development. Now, the question is, does the call for a critical engagement with our values imply that such values are imposed, or that it's like a subscription to a form of meta-narrative? The answer here is no. But first, it will make us see that self-knowledge is a crucial factor in the determination of our place in the cultural dialogue brought about by the relationship of the multiple systems that constitute the world order. This will enable us also to see where we are and where we are going, and the aspects of our other forms of life that we need to take, you know, to us, that where we are going, that will take us to where we are going. Now, for the borrowed cultural items, because there's some kind of negotiation going on now, to be significant in the recipient culture requires the shaping of some aspects of our culture, especially the mental outlook of the people manifested both in their aesthetic beliefs and in their customs and habits. When this happens, the recipient culture strives to see the kind of modification in the culture that promote modern ways of thinking on man and society. Now, if the above is all that appraising our values and practice is all about, then it is difficult to do this in an orientation that is provincial. This is because there is a sense in which cultures are local and separate. And there is an equally important sense in which we not only mean, but we must be concerned with cultural activities afar. This is from Singer. This is because cultural boundaries are not cast in iron. This is to say that cultures and by extension identity are constantly in the making in consonance with the dynamics of human struggle. As a result, it is subject to constant evaluation depending on the nature of our socioeconomic realities and the goals we have set for ourselves. In other words, it is only by adaptation of this culture, to use Thompson's phrase, is a society able to satisfy its changing needs within the context of its physical and human environment. Now, thus far, we have said that the method that best accounts for the interests and aspirations of Africans cannot be that which promotes or emphasizes indigenous values. This, no doubt, the content will be unnecessarily insular, that would be too provincial. We therefore say that the model which suits our efforts to cope with the forces that are detrimental to our survival is that which enlarges our conception of the universe and reality, and by extension, the epistemology. I will provide an understanding of the concept and a critical appraisal of our values. Here, the critical engagement with our culture does not mean submission to a meta-narrative. If, for anything, it means that we examine our culture in comparison with what obtains elsewhere to identify the areas that need to be adjusted in line with the challenges that we have in our environment. To undermine this is to create an illusion, to use Lawi's words, that we know everything about man and his environment and the knowledge of ourselves. Thank you.
The title of our presentation, we're going to go very fast so we can cover a lot of ground. It's Modernism and Cultural Expressions in University Campus Design in a Developing Country, and it's a case study of two Nigerian universities. We're going to focus on Obafemi Awolowo University as well as University of Ibadan. So basically, you know, our argument, what we're going to talk about is in the early to the mid 20th century, as a result of colonialism and independence across Africa, modernism, which is a style of architecture, became very prominent in major Nigerian cities and towns. And modernism was reflected in the public projects designed and executed by expatriate engineers and architects, and mainly, you know, there are lots of modern architecture precedents in campus architecture across Nigeria, especially in the first generation universities. So, but our argument is most of the discussion when it comes to modern architecture in books focus mainly on Europe and the Americas. You know, there's very limited information available on the African continent, especially West Africa. And, you know, there are lots of precedents that we feel that the design or the architecture community can benefit from, basically. And just to give you a basic background and theoretical perspective, Maxwell Fry and Jane Drew were the modernists who planned the University of Ibadan between 1948 and 1958. And then Ariel Sharon planned Obafemi Awolowo University in 1961. And basically their approach was influenced by the Bauhaus style, because both of those architects were influenced by Bauhaus, Walter Gropius and Hans Meyer. And they also, you know, Maxwell Fry and Jane Drew actually worked with Corbusier, who's a protagonist of international style architecture in designing India. So they used some of those modernist principles when they came to Nigeria as well. So in the first two decades of the University of Ife, the international or the Bauhaus style really affected the designs of the campus, basically. And just to give you an overview of the modern movement, right, subscribes to the definition of architecture by the Roman architect Vitruvius in the 10 books of architecture, written probably in 15 BC and dedicated to his emperor Caesar Augustus for building projects. And basically, the main components of the idea is that architecture must have firmness, which means it must be structurally stable. Commodity, it must be useful and functional, and then delight, it must be beautiful or aesthetically pleasing. So the modern movement believes more in the first two qualities, with emphasis on maximizing the properties of the modern materials and the functionality while avoiding ornamentation. And architecture is not only about one building or project, but it's actually about how the building, how it fits into the environment, and the context is very important. And the building and the overall environment must be functional. So basically, that gives you a summary of the modern movement. So I'll turn over to Dr. Jayoba to talk about the impact at OAU.
All right. I'm going to introduce how the modern movement actually acculturized, you know, some of the context of our environment into the architecture of these universities. Now, in the design of the buildings, from the whole to the parts, and from the parts to the whole, you know, the Ariel Sharon, please don't confuse him with Sharon, the politician. This one was actually schooled in Bauhaus, which is one of the first formal schools of architecture. And the concept of group architecture is what he brought to bear on the organization, the site layout of the Obafemi Awolowo University. This group architecture, we believe, reflects and invokes the African communal spirit. That is, relating each building to the surrounding, to the surroundings, and by repetition of blocks and by uniformity in expression. It reflects the Yoruba idea, the communal spirit of the African community. Also, you notice that at different levels, courtyards are employed as the open spaces. These courtyards exist in levels and hierarchies. And this idea was borrowed from the traditional Yoruba architecture into the modern movement to make the buildings and the spatial organization, you know, reflect the kind of community that we have in Africa. And using this culture at different levels, scales, and sizes, they were able to organize buildings and group of buildings and the different parts and sections and in-between spaces. So you have a unified whole in the overall arrangement. Also, there's a respect for the natural environment, which is one of the things that is critical to the African site. There's a balance of built form and the natural ecosystem and in the environmental context. You also notice that the colors blend well, you know, with the natural landscape. And there's a respect for natural features in the way the buildings fit into the topography. And a few of them dominate the space without being unnecessarily unsightly. The other very important thing is that the pedestrian is made the king. That is when you compare pedestrian and vehicular movement. This is to allow for social interaction, which is part of the African communal life. You find out that students, academics, and non-academics have unplanned interaction with one another, which is part of the simultaneity in the interaction system of the African community. There's this plaza that is also the organizing element in the main administrative core of the building, where you have the administrative building on one side, and then the library, and the outdoor and indoor performance space, which is the Ebijuwa hall. You have symbolism. That is, you have the Opa Oroyo, which is Oroyo is supposed to be the first son, the first son of the progenitor of the Yorubas, the Ebijuwa. And that staff occupied a prominent position where the view at the entrance of the large plaza, that's this one, large open courtyard, terminates beside the ramped entrance to the library. Also in terms of climatic response, which is what the international style also translated into a kind of tropical architecture. They deployed the socio-cultural culture spaces fitted into the natural context. This tropical architecture borrowed the courtyard from Yoruba traditional architecture in the search for lighting, ventilation, and social space. Then all the other practical and scientific decisions were add-ons, like the stack ventilation that is prominent and the balance of hard and soft
landscape. So
talk
University
about
University of Ibadan. Yes. Okay, so University of Ibadan was designed by Maxwell Fry and Jim Drew. We only have 2 minutes left, so I'll do that real quickly. And phase one was completed. You know, it was formerly University College Ibadan. And, you know, after independence from colonial rule, the UK decided to invest in education in its colonies. So that's how UI came to be. And, you know, the campus offers what is called a brand of tropical architecture. And, you know, again, like the group architecture that Dr. Jai Urban mentioned earlier on, courtyards are very prominent in the design because, you know, you couldn't just take the international style the way it was in Europe and just put it in Africa, because you need cross ventilation, you know, and the building needs to breathe, basically. So in the case of University of Ibadan, we find this wonderful intricate screen wall patterns that were actually derived from patterns from traditional environments as well. So, you know, let's see, they were very sympathetic to the course, the African course. Maxwell Fry and Drew. They were a husband and wife team, and they actually wanted to fit the building into the landscape and minimally affect the landscape. Yes. This is the image of Kenneth Dike Library, which is University of Ibadan Library, and you can see it's also made out of reinforced concrete, but the screen wall ventilation that allows the building to breathe actually uses patterns from the indigenous environment as well to create that screen wall. An example of trenchard ore, you know, again, the buildings on campus are grouped around courtyards. You know, courtyards were very common in traditional spaces. If you study, and in our overall paper, we're going to also include, you know, the whole transition from indigenous Yoruba traditional spaces where the king's palaces are, and even, you know, buildings are grouped around the courtyard. There's the impluvium style architecture where the functions are grouped around the courtyard. So they borrow from that idea and they use it in the planning of the campus to ensure that the building breathes a lot too. You know, so they want us to conclude now. So we'll just go to the future. Our goal is tropical architecture reverence the surrounding environment, right? The concept of good architecture was very, very important. And we believe that there's some practices, you know, like the sustainable practices, even though today in architecture, we talk a lot about sustainable design practices. We actually believe that indigenous cultures were actually more sustainable than contemporary, you know, contemporary societies now, because they actually practiced using materials that were found readily available. Even people who were not formally trained evolved like the impluvium style building, and the buildings were great. The materials they used were readily available. They were not importing materials from Europe and places like that, and cutting down trees and affecting the environment so much, you know. So we are proposing that current practices should reference some of those indigenous and sustainable practices from before. So I think we'll conclude by saying that the architecture of universities in the developing world should always account for the gains of the past, reject the problems of the past and the present, and project into the future. Thank you so much.
Chair and members of the audience, the paper is titled Creativity and Fledgling Faith World Democracy. The emphasis is on social political activism in the poetry of Fodia Ofen. The paper is written in four sections. The first section is introduction and reviews the role of creativity in liberation struggle throughout the world, starting from the American independence, main struggle for independence. We mentioned the role that Thomas Paine and Thomas Jefferson played in prose writing. Thomas Paine wrote the Common Sense, while Jefferson wrote the Declaration of Independence. These two helped in the struggle for independence that led to the Declaration of Independence in America. We also cite the example of a Negro poet, both the old and Negro poets, that poetry also added to the call for the struggle for the abolition of slavery in America. And then, of course, in the 1950s, during the struggle for independence, literature, creativity, poetry, rules were also instrumental in the spirit of anti-colonial struggle. Like, in fact, some of these writers, in the end, after using their writings to encourage a political struggle, became the presidents of the country. Thomas Jefferson was one. And then you know of Counter, who also became the president of his country. Agostino Neto was also a poet, and he became the president of Angola. What we are seeing here is that from the cradle of nation building up to modern democracy. Creativity in form of poetry, prose, and drama have added to the forces of struggle for independence. Now, the second section of the paper is on third world legitimate democracies. We distinguish here between the first world, the second world, and the third world. The third world is on a particular emphasis. All these countries of the third world include today, roughly described as the developing countries of the world, including Asia and North America, including capitalist Venezuela and the communist North Korea. And they also include the very rich Saudi Arabia and very poor Mali. Now, there are certain indices for third world countries, which include high infant mortality, low economic development, high level of poverty, low industrialization, and then dependent on foreign technology. So these third world countries face so many challenges, including political instability, economic and cultural imperialism, corruption, and financial profligacy, military and civilian dictatorship, and so on and so so forth. And after the struggle for independence, poetry, drama, and the prose have continued in the reconstruction of the African third world. Now, recently, we are familiar with what has come to be known as the Arab Spring. Now, because of the nature of poverty, bad governance, there has been political instability in these countries. And many of these nations have risen up, the peoples have risen up to attack and struggle for a change. And we are saying that even in the Arab Spring, which is a very recent feature, literature, prose, music, dance have continued to be an inspiring spirit for these revolutions. Some of these revolutions, especially the Tunisian revolution, the Egyptian revolution, which inspired other revolutions like the Libyan Revolution of 2001, the Yemen uprising of 2001 to 2011 to 2012, the Syrian Spring crisis of December 2014, then the Jordan Revolution of 2001 to 2002. All these, when we look at the background, we notice that writers, poetry, music, have been a means of communication to inspire the people against bad governance. The third section is on creativity and Arab revolution. As we said, this revolution perhaps would not have attained the level it did if writers had not added force through the writing. Then the fourth section is all their famous resistance poetry and the third world democracy, or they are famous with poetry and the third world democracy. Now, writers have contributed a lot to the changing situation in third world democracies. Odiafemu is one of them. Odiafemu belongs to the so-called second generation of Nigerian or African writers, different from the first generation to which belong Wolesoyinka, J.B. Clark, and John Pepe Clark. Now, the second generation Nigerian writers are different from the first in the sense that the first generation only drew the attention of the masses to the social contradiction in the society without necessarily recommending a solution. But the second generation Nigerian African writers do not only draw the attention of the masses to the social contradiction in the society, to the acts of misgovernance, they also recommend a solution to misgovernance. Now, although a writer like Neil Oshendare, who is the leader of the second generation, believes in revolution, in calling the masses to revolt for social evolution, the poet understudy is different from Neil Oshendare, who belongs to the second generation also, in the sense that while Neil Oshendare stays in his study and calls for revolution without necessarily going out to participate in the revolution, the Odia Ofemu is a sociopolitical activist. He does not stay in his study and call for the masses to revolt, but he is outside whenever there is a occasion for revolution, for civil activism. He goes out and then leads, conscientizes the masses, moves the masses. He identifies with the masses and even not only conscientizes them to revolt against bad governance, but is also an active participant in the revolution. Now he sees the entire world, being a poet, he sees the entire world as his province, whether in his own country, Nigeria, or outside. He gets there and involves actively in any social political activism. Now he's author of about 11 volumes of poetry, but in this study we've taken only three. And then he illustrated the three we have taken include even the titles. From the titles alone, you will see that he is a real activist. In the study, we've looked at his title, his book titled I Will Ask Questions with Stones If They Take My Voice. I Will Ask Questions with Stones If They Take My Voice. And then the other book we have discussed here is Abolishing Caracas. And he wrote this when he traveled to Venezuela and met the Venezuelan revolution. Since the war, he's a province. He, in another person's country, went out and led the revolution against the governance in Venezuela. Now, this proves that he is not just an armchair poet who sits there to study and then prescribe on what to do. Now, there is also his other title that we have studied here, Go Tell It to the Generals. Go Tell It to the Generals, in which he descends on military rulers. Here, he was an active participant of the pro-democracy crisis in Nigeria as a result of Babangida's annulment of a June 12th election. We all remember the 3 days civil strife. Here, Odia Ofemu was not only asking the masses to go out, he came out and was full participant in the pro-democracy protest in Nigeria. And so with this, we're saying that Odia Ofemu is not just an armchair poet. He does not only believe in drawing the attention to racial contradictions in our society. He's an active participant, a social political activist for the betterment of third world democracies. Thank you.
Yes, Dr. Olai.
First question to Professor Onyeaghalaji. Just a straight one. How do you handle a work of art that is aesthetically appealing or morally obnoxious? How do you handle it within the context of what you presented? For the draw of Professor Asujo and Professor Jayoba, beautiful presentation. But I was left hanging. As in, okay, yes, all these beautiful designs that you analyzed, most of them are breaking down now. So I was expecting at the end of the day that you're going to give us some kind of ideas about rethinking architectural design in contemporary time. You know? Then secondly, I don't know, this appears to me like a contradiction. Number one, you were praising the international style of those guys you mentioned. You know, how they were able to combine, you know, modernism and traditional, you know, in placing those buildings, respect for Yoruba design. But in your conclusion, you see, you just went straight and recommended traditional style. I'm not sure whether you need to clarify that to me. For Professor Uwat, which is more effective? Is it Odia the poet or Odia the activist?
Thank you. Yes, I have my boss in the audience, and I want to recognize him before you guys. He is Professor Federico. You are welcome. Former advisor.
Thank you very much. Unfortunately, my comments are not exactly mainstream, they're tangential. To the architects, I mean, good presentation as pointed out. But the criticism for me is not really robust enough. Being somebody from MIFE, I know we have some structures on campus that are not functional. I mean, look at this lecture theater that is almost pumped into the ground. At the Faculty of Science, if you don't have electricity, it's useless. You can put on AC, you can put on those parts of the IFE phenomenon should be pointed out. UI is not exactly the first university in Nigeria. I saw you mentioning that. UI didn't become a university until December 62. Prior to that, it was just a college. My brother spoke about quality control in art forms. I was wondering, is that art not about abstraction? How do you begin to control? Are you going to suggest to me the way I must draw or paint? I don't understand if you want to shed some light on that. The last speaker said, when we say revolution, again, we must be careful how we conceptualize this. It's not central to your presentation, but for me, a political scientist, I think it's critical. What you have in Egypt, for instance, or the entire Middle East and North America, that we start with, is it really a revolution?
Uprising.
It has some revolutionary currents. Mm-hmm. Look at Egypt. What Egypt, where Egypt was before the so-called revolution is where it is now. Dominance by the military. So let's be a bit careful deployment of this concept.
Let them respond and then I'll take your questions. Yes.
I'll go ahead and just quickly respond to the questions. Yeah, we do know that, you know, there are beautiful buildings breaking down, right? Because even some of the buildings, even though some were still replicas of modern architecture brought to Africa. And even in terms of materials, they imported the materials as well. But you know, they still, some of those buildings, if you think about today, responded more to the context and they responded more to the needs of the people than even the newer buildings that are being built today. Because it's even worse today. You know, like in my own perception, I feel like today, things are just direct copies of what is happening in the West. Whereas, some of those modern, the people like Maxwell Fry and Jane Drew, they actually looked into some of the traditional practices and then they incorporated some ideas, but they couldn't do it so fully. But then what you find today, there's still some, you know, I mean, I like to reference the architect Demasoroko, although some of my architecture colleagues will say he's an artist, because in a lot of his buildings, he really pays attention to, you know, to the environment, the materials, and he uses the indigenous, you know, forms and symbols, as well as, you know, he uses the principles, and then he thinks about sustainability and all that when he's planning. You know, it was hard for us to do that presentation in 10 minutes. So I hope you understand that you can't really cover so much ground, because by the time we were able to talking about UI, you already told us we had 2 minutes left. So I think the paper will expand more on that. We're not saying that there are no problems with the buildings. The buildings are breaking down. Even some of the buildings that had flat roofs, they went back and they added gables to them, because, you know, flat roofs don't really work in a tropical region. You have to have a slope so that the water runs off. And then, you know, in terms of Professor Mimiko's comments about sinking the building into the ground, of course, we need daylighting. You know, you need daylighting in a building like Nigeria, for example, especially when you have power outages. But, you know, those designers actually evolved a style that, like cross ventilation and siting, the way you site the building, were direct results of some of their analysis and their solutions.
Yeah.
So maybe Dr. Okay. Ayoba might add a little bit.
All right, part of the essence of the paper is actually to see how the international style was transformed in the context of the tropical region to provide tropical architecture as it is analyzed today. Now, many of the new buildings on campuses and new campuses being planned don't even have these characteristics that existed then, that were transformed from international style to tropical architecture. So actually, when you look at the new buildings of today compared to the buildings that were even done then, that we are critiquing, the design proposals then are even better than the ones that are being done today.
Yes.
And you know, there is this continuous search for a Nigerian architecture. And if we're searching for Nigerian architecture and we don't even understand what exists in the past, and we cannot look at it relative to what is presently being done, how do we chart a way to the future? That's part of the essence of this paper. You will also notice, Professor Mimiko, that in our conclusion, we said we should learn from the good things that have been done in the past, and the good things, the bad things that were also done in the past, yes, the problems of the past, so we can know how to react appropriately in the present. Part of, we have to understand that many of these people were Europeans, they were foreigners, and sometimes the context of when they designed has also changed from then to now. Because then there was electricity and all that. They imagine that we would not have problems with electricity. That's why they had all those enclosed lecture theaters. But today, we know where we are and that things have broken down.
Yes, sir.
The first question, who is more effective, or the poet and or the activist? I think the poet is synonymous with the activist. It takes a poet who has the guts to do what he is doing to go out protesting, unlike poets like maybe J.P. Clark, who doesn't have the poet, of course, I mean, the one doesn't have the gut, of course, who is at the center of a famous volume, the poet Clyde, where he accuses him of staying at the back and fearing detention. And that's why he writes the type of poetry that he's writing. But it takes a man with who has the guts, who's daring, who does not fear detention, nor in, you know, assassination or murder, to write or to do the type of thing that we now know, the level of censorship, especially during the military and governance, that the danger that puts fit. And we know what happened to journalists, to politicians who protested. Many of them were detained for protesting. And put just take Odiar Femu to be an activist. Then when we talk about revolution, well, revolution at least in the sense that sit tight rulers who have governed the African states between 20 and 40 years were removed. Mubarak, we know how long he ruled, and in Libya, Gaddafi ruled for so long. So even though in Egypt, Egypt has almost returned to the same level, but at least sit tight. Presidents have been removed. I think revolution in that sense, and then that actually is gone. I think yes, I think there is a change. Thank you.
We have some hands at the back. Yes,
I think we are here to respond to.
Oh, okay. You have a question?
Yeah, yes, I have two questions. I want to start with the question raised by Bob, and the question is about freedom and. Creativity, and that's why I can summarize it. And as a matter of fact, one of the criteria of creativity is freedom, because without freedom, creativity may be limited. As a matter of fact, you know, when my mind is determined, it makes it impossible to be creative. Yeah, but again. When I talk about political control, I'm not only emphasizing the idea of creating a law to stop people from being creative. In the work, I emphasize the idea of revaluation of values from not just the government, also but from the people, you know, from the teachers. So these are contemporary musicians, for instance. Actually from booms, and most of them also attend different groups or even schools or universities. I think we should start probably emphasizing the idea of moral instructions. It's also one of the ways of political control, because if, for instance, we socialize our youths, we socialize our children, we socialize ourselves in the idea of some basic moral values, perhaps we could have effect in the idea of productivity, I mean, in our society. Then, secondly, they also goes towards the question Prof raised too, the idea of aesthetically appealing, but morally empty. But that is even the cause of our work, trying to interrogate the moral foundation within the arts project. The truth of the matter is that there's nothing virtually we can do when the work is out, as a matter of fact, in terms of, because we are not going to input those moral principles. But what we could do, as a matter of fact, as I said again, is also the good idea of moral conscientization. Because if we have a work that's appealing, but the lyrics of those works, in terms of music, for instance, are really, really, really amazing. I'm not sure it's the only word I want to go and buy it. For instance, if we have 10 people, there are maybe 5 people may not be interested in it because of the lyrics. One other people may be interested because of it. So what?
No, no. Of course, they are buying them. That's why we are doing this interrogation. Why we are raising the issue is that, you see, the only thing we could do is to conscientize ourselves and our people. In these modern days, we cannot stop the works. We can't. There's nothing we can do about it. In fact, the works that are appealing today, that people are buying more, are this contemporary music. And that's where, what if you put tradition now, that's what you hear. You know, but what we're saying is that I think we can do something, even though we cannot stop them, but we begin to conscientize morally our people. Yeah.
Okay. My question is to the first presenter. I need some clarifications. Because if I heard you well, we were discussing moral values as if it is it's a universal thing. Downplaying the import of ethical relativism, you know, that it can change from time to time and from place to place, or even from religion to religion. What can be upheld as the moral values 100 years ago may not always be the same now. So I need some clarification sometime.
Yes, please. Okay, first, I think in between Prof and your thinkers, your philosophers. Mm-hmm. So when they answer this, okay, my worry is this. If you are talking about aesthetics, what aesthetics do you want? If you say that the music that been dished out has no moral content, question is, society define the moral they want. Now, who defines the moral they want? Who defines the aesthetics that we want? Number two, who dispenses the aesthetics? If that is the case, then how do we now want it changed? How does it work? That is the question I have here. Number two is for my architect friend. It is this. Nice work. But I'm worried for two things. Modernism has minimal respect for culture. Now for you to tell me that what we do is to be celebrating modernism, I'm worried. Because even in Chandigarh, there is no Indianness in everything that was done until some years back. Before the two of them came back to Nigeria, you see that building at the University of Ibadan, UCH, as a sample, the sign with climate. So the case of Ife, the issue at Ife that I see there that looks a little bit, that is based upon culture, it's a quadrangle of four people. One, Awolo himself, Oluwasoni, Sharon, who is responsible for the call, and Department of Landscape Architecture here in Wisconsin, who, through a very simple thing, said, let's do this what they want. They want their cultural expression. Now, if that's the case, the other one is that, do we now say the courtyard system at Ife is Yorubas? I did not say any Yoruba in it. Because courtyard is not even, it's not attached to a particular culture. The Arabs have their own courtyard system. Yorubas have their own courtyard system. The white have their own courtyard system. So I am worried about that one. But again, if we are saying individual building is based upon cultural iconography, I agree. Now, that's for Ife. For Ibadan, I find it difficult to see the comparison or the agreements you have between Ibadan and Ife. Because the two distinct schools of thoughts. One, based upon clustering system that is embellished or cladded with culture, they agree, individual building, that is architecture of the building, not architecture of the university, two distinct things. That is the architecture of the building, but the architecture of the university is where the issue is. And that's why I'm a little bit worried on those two things. Whose courtyard? Yoruba courtyard, Arab courtyard, or the universal courtyard system that defines the architecture of the university? Thank you.
We have those 2 minutes or 3 minutes.
Okay. The fact that other cultures also have courtyards does not mean that the Yoruba courtyard does not exist.
It's existing.
Yes, it exists. And we know what the functions of the Yoruba courtyard are. If the spaces there perform the same functions as the Yoruba courtyard, then it could be compared to the Yoruba courtyard. The Yoruba courtyard is functional, it's a social interaction space, and they exist.
It was also climatic.
Yes, climatic, and they exist at different levels. So we can compare it. I understand what you mean. The international style talks about function, structure, and aesthetics. Aesthetics without embellishments. That is without all what we're doing today, going back to Doric column and all the Greek and all that. Those are all the things that modern architecture spoke against. But when the modernists came to Nigeria, you could also see that there were still no embellishments or unnecessary decorations. But they tried to adapt international style to at least the climate and the environment. That's what we're saying, basically. That they adapted international style to the social context. In terms of layout, of course, the idea in University of Ibadan, and then the one in Obafemi Awolowo University, they are different. But when you think about the University of Ibadan, there are no clearly delineated areas like academic, residential areas, and all that. It was the whole idea of having a campus that is well integrated,
walkable,
so that distances in between staff residential area, student residential area, it's all happening like simultaneously in the same place, and that too by itself is a way of facilitating, of reducing movement in between the different parts, and then ensuring that there is multiple interactions.
Yes, collaboration and exchange.
That's what we're saying.
Yeah, and to add to that, so you know, even the whole notion of modernism, tropical architecture came out of the tropical countries. So, yeah, tropical architecture came out of tropical countries.
I could respond to the question of the question of relativism. But the two questions are most like the who sets the standard and the question of relativism. When I was discussing my work, I stated that one of the problems that the idea of African philosophy had at the beginning was this a challenge from the Western population that Africans do not have the idea of aesthetics or intellectual virtue because they were using their Western rational criteria of value. And I also said that but Africans defined their aesthetics by stating that Africans have culture, they have worldview, and their aesthetic appreciation reflects such worldview, just like the Western aesthetics reflects such worldview. But again, we should also be very careful of relativism here, you know, because one problem that also arose from that African definition of their aesthetics was that they said that the Westerners have their own conception different, the Africans have their own conception different. In other words, the Westerners are rational, okay? They have this aesthetic contemplative attitude. Africans do not have, we also have functional attitude and all that. It's almost like debasing African rationality too. So what I'm trying to say in essence is that as far as we are human, there are certain values that are universal that you know you have everywhere as far as human beings are concerned. You have to recognize that, such that cultural universalism cannot be completely abrogated from human circle. So if we are talking about relativism, we have to be cautious and the extent we can go, because if relativism means everything must be relativized, including relativism itself, then it means it doesn't have any moral tenor. That means we could have some cultural peculiarities, but not cultural uniqueness, in the sense that as far as we are human beings, we are human beings everywhere. We have the same rationality, as a matter of fact. But culture becomes an interaction of human beings with an environment, with a social geographical setting.
could create an, I mean, a world of life that could be different from other people's world of life.
Okay. In fact, the uniqueness that you are talking about, which you touched to relativism, maybe it's based on your understanding of art as the expression of people's experience. And in that sense, it creates the identity of the people. But that culture itself is dynamic. And that dynamism can also be explained as a result of the interaction with different other cultures. And when that happens, then you can begin to talk about universalism. You can draw some common values from there. And then universalism is brought to the fore. So with that, you can't really stand on the platform of relativism as such.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.